Good morning. Welcome. I'm Laura Fryer, and I work at Oculus. And you know, I've known John about 15 years. When we were setting up the Xbox Advisory Board, that's when we met, because of course, John was the first person we called. A few days ago, someone asked me if I would go ahead and introduce John, and of course I said yes. I mean, it is the easiest job on the planet, right? I mean, everybody knows who John Carmack is. Of course, it's a funny thing because it's actually a really hard job, because everybody knows who John Carmack is. I mean, you guys know about Doom and Quake and the rockets. You know that John has been on the cutting edge of technology for almost his entire life. I mean, that's why we're all here. But what you may not know about John is why he's so successful. And John has a lot of great traits, but I'm just going to cover two. The first is, John works incredibly hard. He is one of the most productive people I have personally ever met in the games industry. And the other reason is that John has the heart of a scientist. He wants to collect the data. If John wonders if direction one or direction two is the right thing to do, he doesn't spend his time in theoretical hand-wringing. He tries it, right? He goes out, he does the experiment, he collects the data, and best of all, he shares it with all of us. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming John Carmack.
All right, they asked me to defrag the crowd, but it looks like you're already fully packed here. So I briefly considered maybe actually making a presentation for this, but I figure I've made it this far without ever using PowerPoint, so I'm just gonna wing it again. So most of this is going to be my personal opinions. I am gonna have a few things that I will call out as official Oculus positions, and there will be some noteworthy things to talk about there. But the first thing that I get asked a lot, and in fact, I put out kind of a call for topics yesterday on Twitter, and of course this came up a couple of times, is why mobile VR at all? Why aren't I working on the PC with the latest and greatest high-end stuff and all the fun gear to do there? Why am I working with these kind of mobile toys and in fact spending almost all of my time working almost exclusively on this? And it's a fair question, especially for Oculus, where most of the Oculus base is the PC gamer, you know, the hardcore PC gamer that doesn't mind buying expensive peripherals. So you could say, well, this is the job that Oculus was sort of signed up for, and we've got a ton of people working really hard on that. But I think that there's an opportunity here to go beyond that in many ways. And while we're at the Game Developers Conference, I can still say I think that virtual reality is bigger than gaming. I mean, virtual reality, we talk about this as this final platform, as this new way that people are interacting with computers, and that's still a good thing for gaming because we've seen this over and over. As new platforms go out and people go to something for email or for social, and they wind up having gaming experiences there, and it winds up being brand new markets that new players can come in and kind of break brand new ground there. So, it's almost a cliche when people talk about serving a billion users. It's like, oh, be serious. We should be talking about the things right in front of us. And I usually am like that. I don't spend much time going on about these grand visionary things, but I honestly do see a world with a billion people using virtual reality headsets. It's just so fundamental that so much of what people do in the world deals with changing the environment around them. And many of those things that they change the environment for are purely aesthetic visual things that we can replicate to greater and lesser degrees in virtual reality. So I think there's going to be huge reasons why large fractions of the world population will eventually want to do virtual reality. They'll get drawn into it by lots of different things, and eventually they'll be playing games in it. So there's no way that a PC peripheral or a game console winds up being the path that scale of people interact with. But we do have a path to that, and that's with mobile technology. I mean, we have billion plus smartphones, we're heading towards a billion tablets. These are markets where it's amazing when you think about it that we're addressing these sizable fractions of the entire world's population. And I think VR does have the possibility of following in those trends. So I do think that in the long run, mobile technology is going to be probably the dominant platform. It already is in many ways. But there's real questions about 5 years, 10 years. The VR headset of our dreams doesn't have wires on it. It's probably going to be built out of more mobile technology. But that VR headset of our dreams isn't here now and isn't going to be here in the next couple years. So you could make arguments. Do you start with the highest end, most powerful, potent system and try to perfect the experience and figure we're going to migrate form factor later? Or do we start with the form factor and improve performance? Or do we do both? And you know, we've decided as a company that we are going to do both. And that does cause some difficulties. And there are problems when your company is not laser focused on one single product. It makes things a little bit more challenging. You will have various internal divides about how resources get allocated and so on. But I think that it is a completely valid strategy. We have all the wonderful stuff that we're doing on the PC, the high-end work that lets us build these near photorealistic scenes in some cases, running with all the benefits of very high quality position tracking, very high refresh rates. But what we can do on the mobile is still pretty exciting. Like my 70-year-old mother carries a Gear VR with her traveling now with a Theta panoramic camera to take vacation photos in 360-degree panoramas. And this is the type of thing that we're going to be surprised how many people that we would not expect to be caring about virtual reality wind up picking things up for things like this. You know, it turns out that people kind of like photos and videos, and we can do photos and videos with virtual reality headsets in a way that is very powerfully better than what you get with traditional devices. And that's going to bring tons and tons of people in. And they may come for different things, but they'll find games there as the platform evolves. So I do firmly believe that this is an important direction, and I'm going to try to convince all of you that it's a direction that's worth spending your time and resources developing games for. So the path that took us here is, it's kind of interesting how this went around the world and back, where the project, you could say, started with Samsung has a large facility in Dallas, actually, where they have some R&D teams and different things. And one of the teams there prototyped this little phone holder. Now, we've seen phone holders before. You know, one of the first things that I did when I got on my virtual reality kick was I got the little Hasbro VR viewer. You stuck your iPhone in and looked through it. And it was interesting. It had some terrible software experiences with it. And Palmer made his own VR phone holder headset, and we've got Cardboard Now and a few other things. But whenever I look at those things, it was always clear to me from the very first time I looked at this, it's like, okay, this could be so, so much better than what we're actually seeing here. You know, it's just, they're not doing it right. And there's that sort of sense that many technical people will see or feel when you see something and you know what it could be, and you know it could be important, and you see companies just doing it wrong. There's that powerful desire to fix it and do it right and show them sort of how it's supposed to be done. So this team in Dallas at Samsung built a little phone holder. They actually did a really a pretty nice job on it, pretty good ergonomics, nice holder. They took lenses from a DK1, and they were doing this internal demo at Samsung. And they wound up sending it over to kind of the Samsung higher-ups in Korea. And at about that time, Brendan was visiting Samsung over there, trying to arrange for displays for our PC products, because we really wanted the OLED displays. And that was a time when Samsung was like, okay, well, we can talk about displays, but we also want to talk about this, and brought out the little VR holder. And at the time, we're like, okay, this looks kind of interesting, but the software experiences are sort of what we've seen from similar phone holders in the past, which is to say, not very impressive, and certainly not anywhere close to even DK1 level of virtual reality experiences. All the things that go wrong with not having the sensors, the processing, the buffering, all the things that happen in the motion to photons latency chain, practically every one of them being broken in some way, as well as not having graphics right, all these things. But Brendan still took the thing back, was thinking about it, and this was right at the time when I was talking to Oculus about being a technical advisor, taking some position there. And when I saw the little holder, and it was very quickly clear to me, I looked at the software there, okay, this is not very good, but I can do something really good with this. This hardware, I know what's in there, it's pretty powerful. We can do something that's pretty credible with this. And that literally was the thing that made me come full-time at Oculus, was this chance to take this vision of mobile virtual reality and say, this is something that can be done in this reasonably close period of time, not years off into the future, where you'd get most people to say, yeah, sure, mobile will be the future sometime, 5 years, 10 years, whatever, but it's not right now. But I could look at that, look at the specs, and say, no, I think we can do this pretty much right now. And we bought into this, we started working on it. For the first 6 months or so, it was pretty much me writing software. And 1 year ago today, not today, but 1 year ago at about this week, we had demos that we're showing at the Mobile World Congress last year based on a Galaxy S5 shown to some partners sort of behind closed doors. And it had some of the basic experiences that we wound up shipping with. It had a cinema, it had 360 panoramic videos, it had some static stills, some basic game experiences. And Samsung was like, we can productize this right now. And that, that's a lot of tension between Oculus and Samsung about exactly what constitutes the right VR product. And Oculus has had a lot of fear of, the term that we hear internally a lot is poisoning the well. There's this fear that if a really bad VR product goes out, it could set the industry back to the 90s. I mean, some of the old timers here will remember the virtual reality craze of the 90s when it was gonna be the future and it was gonna change everything and it was gonna impact the social structures of the world and all of this high-minded stuff. And of course, it left huge smoking craters in the landscape of all of these companies that, that never made any money, lost a lot of investors' money. And then we had people that were afraid to touch VR for 20 years. And we would literally run into people saying, it's like, oh, VR, that worked out so badly. I don't think I want to be involved in that. So it was something not without, some cause for concern. So, Oculus was in the position of, we know what we're doing on the PC. We're building towards this, this great product that does essentially everything right. It has all the position tracking. It has the high refresh rate. There was this question about this mobile product. It's like, okay, it's running John's demos pretty good here, but it's not, it's not running other people's Unity code. Is this only gonna be for like super ultimately optimized things? It's 60 frames per second, low persistence. It can cause eye strain for some people with the brightness flickering. It doesn't have position tracking. You sway like this, you get sick. All of these concerns, and the idea that Oculus would push this out before the product where we're doing everything right was a big, was a big concern internally. So what wound up being the positioning on this was the term Innovator Edition was slapped on this. And I know internally some people probably would have preferred it to be called a developer kit, but Samsung doesn't do developer kits. And it got this tag on it. And I think that it's still probably for the best, because even at this point when we did launch, clearly we're not there on the software side. It was all we could manage to get a store downloading free apps out when the product actually shipped. Only now, we did just this week get paid apps up. I was threatening I was gonna try to buy one on stage, but the platform team did seem to get things out and actually shipped and working there. Internationalization took us a while. We still don't have internationalization on the store. We still don't have in-app purchase. All these things are rolling, but they're still not here now. When we look back at it, the hardware that Samsung developed probably could have gone wide. When we look at the Gear VR, what they ship, the hardware seems to be pretty good, and they probably could have gone out and full blitzed it. But Oculus was taking this position that we had agreed upon with Samsung in the contracts about we could control when it was going to be broadly marketed. And there were a lot of debates internally about what the right time for that would be, and things changed over time. At one point, the thinking was that, well, we can't do mobile VR wide. We can't, what we expect to see out of this is every cell phone store in the, in the world winds up having Samsung premium phones, and then you've got Gear VR sitting there for a demo in the store, which is going to move tons of them, because cell phone stores are full of lots of boring stuff. I mean, people are looking at these phones trying to find something to excite them, and the response that you get from the head-mounted display is so much greater than what you get from whatever the next little gimmick that somebody has to point out and draw your attention to differentiate the phones between them. This is a plan that should be able to move a whole lot of units. But the nightmare scenario was, well, they go out there, people like the demo, they buy them, they take them home, and then they start throwing up. They start having these horrible experiences, and they return them all in droves, and we're tagged as the product with an 80% return rate. You know, these are the nightmare scenarios that keep CEOs awake at night. So we were in this cautious phase of saying, we know how to do VR pretty much right now. We know how to make it comfortable for people by a combination of hardware, systems, and content. We should wait until that's possible. And that was where we were sort of around Oculus Connect several months ago. And at that point, I had kind of laid out and said, okay, well, if this is what it's gotta be, then there's these things that we have to solve. We have to up the refresh rate on the display, and we have to solve position tracking. So for those of you that heard me talk at Connect, I would mention some of these things that I was looking at about deep interlacing the displays, the OLEDs, to be able to get us higher effective refresh rates. And in fact, we were able to put together a research test for that. And it turns out the simple interlace of just kind of every other scan line, then come back in every other one to give you 120 fields a second, that looks fine when you're looking at a static image, but it's fairly easy to move your head at a rate where you line up with the beat frequency of the refresh, and then you can clearly see it as these alternating colored and black bars. So that's not a general solution for higher refresh rates. But we did also do a demonstration on a specialized piece of hardware that let us do much deeper interlaces, where you take like an 8 swizzle pattern and interleave them all like that. And that does seem to work out okay, but it is not gonna happen that we're getting Samsung Display to make custom display controllers in the real near future for this. So I was pursuing the vision, computer vision logic for the position tracking, and I had a great time spending a little over 2 months kind of getting my feet wet on all the computer vision processing, figuring out the ins and outs of the camera hardware, what we can wind up doing on the mobile systems. And I still think that this is possible in sort of this coming generation of mobile phones to do that in a perhaps always on, still power efficient way. But none of the researchers at Oculus agree with me, and they're the ones with more experience, so you can take that with a grain of salt. But I still hold out hope that that's possible with probably one external lens to increase the field of view, to wind up covering the view so you get more features and you can still pull in and start looking at hand tracking and all this stuff. But what got me off of that was Gear VR launched, it got out into the wild, limited release, direct sale only, all of these restrictions on it, but it got out to enthusiasts, to real people, and a funny thing happened. People kind of like it. It's only 60 hertz refresh rate. You can get eye strain. You can make yourself sick if you do certain things. But the response has been a lot better than almost anyone expected from this. We've had, internally even, the general response was, this was a lot better than I expected it to be. People, especially that are working on very high-end systems and only occasionally looking over at mobile during development when it's not working very well, and when it all comes together in the end and it looks like a consumer product, even if it is an innovator edition, but you take it out of the box, you plug it in, and it works. It's kind of cool. And there's some real advantages to that form factor that people recognize. The fact that it is a consumer product, getting our PC demos to work can sometimes be kind of embarrassing. It's just all the stuff that the hoops you have to jump through to make a high-end PC gaming rig work with this bleeding edge systems, and to have something where you just take it out, you plug it in, and it does its thing. So we had extremely low return rates. The data that we're getting on all of this is very, very good, and we're hearing anecdotally from a lot of media outlets that the response that people have to this product is way better than was expected. And one of the things that's spectacular about the mobile product is that there was a magazine review that was basically making a backhanded comment about how there's very little to do, that we don't have a well-stocked store. But they said the most fun thing to do with Gear VR is show it to other people. And there's a lot of truth to that. It is so much fun for people to just pull something out of their backpack and say, look at this virtual reality headset. And you know, many of us here are jaded from working with VR for a couple years now, but when you wind up taking people that have never seen this and they put it on, they see the intro, and you know, they get the Oculus face just kind of, you know. And we've all seen that when people see the virtual reality for the first time ever, people that are not necessarily enthusiasts, and they are amazed by it, and they're imagining all the things that they can do with this. And you see this in all sorts of walks of lives, not just the hardcore gamer. So one of the key advantages and the reasons for doing the mobile is it's the infection vector for virtual reality. This is the thing where you've got your home PC set up and you can invite your friends over to, you know, to come down and see your VR cave and try everything out, and it's amazing. But Gear VR can go with you on vacation and people see it, and every Gear VR has probably been on 10 different people's heads. It has a huge fan-out ratio, so I think this is going to be extremely important as we look at this broadening out, getting people to buy into virtual reality in general as a concept, because it works. We get this out there, we know what we have to do to make this better, but even in its limited form right now, it is making positive responses in people. So the company is, you know, has pivoted a little bit on this and saying, okay, I guess we don't need to wait for getting everything right. We still want to get that in future mobile products, but we're going to proceed on a modified strategy. So just this week, Samsung announced the Galaxy S6 and the Gear VR 2 for it. It is not radically different from the first Gear VR. It's a little bit lighter weight, you know, a little bit more ergonomic. There's still a lot that can be done. Nose clearance still isn't good enough. The facial interface can still be improved, but it has some modest improvements there. It's got a little ventilation fan on it, which is mostly to cure the fogging issue, where the lenses would fog up when it's cold. And it's an interesting thing about that, where that was more of a problem on the mobile headset than it is on the PC systems. Because the main reason you get fogging is when you get moist air condensing onto a cooler surface. The PC device, because it's sitting there with the electronics in it, winds up heating the entire thing up to, you know, generally above the dew point. But the mobile holder can be sitting at room temperature, and when you put the phone in, it can take 15 minutes for it to sort of equilibrate on temperature. So the fan helps, helps with that. Maybe it helps a little bit with the cooling on the mobile device, but it's probably more than outweighed by the fact that the Galaxy phone is a little bit smaller, it's got a little bit less thermal mass, so thermal is still kind of a wash there. It does have an external USB port, which is mostly so that if you do want to be able to watch multiple movies in a row or something, you can sit there and you can have it on so that it charges while you're watching, which does take a little bit of thermal load off. It won't charge the battery, it doesn't put enough power in to both run it and charge the battery, but it winds up taking a little bit of internal resistance out of the battery. Unfortunately for developers, you can't use that to run ADB while you're using the device, which is a damn shame. That would be really nice not to have to use Wi-Fi for that in all cases, but it's a fundamental problem because when the phone has to be acting in host mode to be able to talk to the sensor in the headset, so it can talk to other devices. We do have the ability to conceivably have add-ons to Gear VR now, and there were some companies that were doing some significant hacks to in-development things to plug in additional peripherals, but that is more feasible now, but it doesn't help out developers too much. There's a few minor technical improvements in the way the display works. One of the problems that plagues Gear VR and all of our OLED-based displays is that you see a one-frame ghost. It's not a smear like an LCD panel would be with long switching times, but you see it most clearly if you have a black background and then something high contrast. You know, when you move around, you won't see a smear across the entire area, but you will see one after image very dimly. And what's happening there is the display has an electrical analog level issue with rising up to the commanded level on the very next frame. On the PC, we can do, we can overdrive this in software in many cases to help out a lot and hide it a little bit better, but that's a pretty significant cost to pay on mobile. So the Galaxy does have a little bit better display on that. It's tightened in a bit. I hope they keep improving that in future displays. It's still not completely gone, but it is a little bit better. There's some system software changes that make the product a little bit better. Notifications work better than, notifications would pretty much destroy the Gear VR experience on Note 4, because what was happening is they would basically be running an entirely separate VR context just for the notifications, so they could have some head tracking, and it never worked. It always wound up missing timing and tearing and having a generally terrible experience when a notification came up. So now it's a simpler thing. It just pops up static things. They're face locked, which is not what you'd like in VR, but they're small, so it's an improvement better than breaking VR, essentially. One other really subtle thing that got changed in the system software, many of you probably aren't aware of this, but recent generations of mobile hardware, their video systems don't continuously scan memory like we've been used to since, you know, for 60 years of CRTs or whatever. To start saving power, a lot of the modern displays actually have embedded frame buffers, so they've got specialized tightly coupled memory on the display, and they only scan in from main memory when the GPU has drawn something there, and then the application processor signals them. So this is an artifact that you would see in some of the Gear VR titles where during loading especially, like a heavy Unity game that might use a couple threads to issue loading commands, you could get, despite having asynchronous time warp running there, which should make everything perfectly smooth, sometimes you would see these lurchy hitches between things or see a tear line crossing across the screen. What was happening there is there's a process on Android called Surface Flinger that winds up figuring out what's needed, what needs to be updated on the screen, and it was in charge of sending this little trigger signal to the display to say, I actually did change something, please scan out on the next frame. The difficulty was, one of the great things we got from Samsung is that we get to run our VR applications at these real-time scheduling rates. You know, we get to set sched FIFO on our rendering thread and our application thread. And this is, you know, this is a hazardous thing at best, and it's one of those things that I expect Google will pick up some of the things that we've done with Gear VR and make them Android standard. I don't expect them to wind up doing this, because it's the type of thing that causes, you know, most Unix programmers to just throw their hands in the air and scream about it, because we do have the ability to completely wedge the CPUs. In theory, with 4 or 8 cores on these modern systems, it shouldn't be a problem, but despite being able to lock the clocks, they'll still shut down the cores. So the situation that would happen is we're loading and we completely wedge 1 or 2 cores that are the only things running, and we're at sched FIFO, so poor Surface Flinger doesn't get scheduled at all, does not send the little command that tells the display that you actually need to update things. And so even though we've drawn a new frame, it's sitting in memory, it didn't get scanned out. So that would be one of the things that could occasionally cause us some problems. So on the Galaxy, we have the display in VR mode. It's back into video mode, where it scans continuously. But at this moment, it's causing us the problem that means if you're doing development mode and developer mode and it's sitting on your desk, it's not updating the screen hardly at all, only when some random thing causes a screen update. So there's still things that need to be sorted out about that. So no fundamental differences. It is more powerful. If you flat out run a Galaxy, it will outperform a Note 4, but you really don't want to do that from a gaming or VR standpoint, because it will overheat really pretty quickly. You can crank up the clocks higher than we had on the Note 4, but I encourage everyone to sort of stick with the same reasonably conservative clocks, try to make things work within those parameters, and keep the heat build up to a reasonable level. So it is still being called an innovator edition. You can see where we're at right now. We're just baby stepping our store out. We are rolling out slowly, internationalization. We're still not ready for Samsung to go out and do their blitz. We expect when everything is ready, Samsung can go out and You'll see ads everywhere. They will push a whole lot of them. We'll be in all the cell phone stores. All these things that we really wanted and sort of expected at the beginning to do. And in fact, I want to personally apologize to some developers that I, early NDA developers, that I may have enthused about all of this, and people that, the early adopters on the developer side that went and built products. The truth is, this year on the Innovator Editions, there's just not going to be that much opportunity to move a whole lot of units. They're being restricted in these various ways. It wasn't what I thought was going to happen if you were pinging me a year ago about this. But that's where we are today. But the big sort of official formal Oculus announcement that we've got here, and there's caveats to this, but we have a strategy now, and we have external forces that are dictating some of this. But Samsung's next product release cycle, now we can't talk about unannounced Samsung products, but they do two major releases a year, so we can all connect the dots on when and where and what this is going to be. And Samsung may decide, this is important to note, that Oculus can't twist Samsung's arm and make them do something. Samsung could decide, hey, we've had enough of virtual reality. It was a fun experiment, but we're not going forward. That's a possibility, and there's nothing that Oculus would be able to do about that. But barring a calamity like that, the official formal strategy is that Oculus goes big, full consumer on Samsung's next release cycle. So that will hopefully be for the new product and then also making it for the products that are going to be sort of available already, like the Galaxy S6 Gear VR 2. The idea would be that when we say we're ready, which is really mostly on Oculus from a platform, infrastructure, software, content level, we're going to be able to sort of back unlock the promotion and sales of multiple products there. So the Samsung's hardware, again, probably could have gone wide with Gear VR 1. It really was on the side of Oculus about not having enough software, not having all the platform stuff all together. We needed more time. But we've got a plan now. We've got a date. You can kind of mark this in the calendars that Oculus is going for it as hard as we can, broad consumer, trying to sell as many units as possible, unleashing Samsung with the next Gear VR. So this gives us some worthwhile timing here, where if we look at this and say, all right, that's going to be around the end of the year, this is where I want everyone here to consider what you're doing the rest of this year, where is this an opportune time to say, I want to take a risk on virtual reality. There's a date now. There's a real plan. You can probably talk to the people at Oculus and get more details about exactly how we're planning on promoting, rolling things out and everything, but we're serious about this, and we want it to go out and move a heck of a lot of units and hopefully be a product that a lot of people can be successful on. The timing for this is something that you obviously can't do a AAA title in short time frame, but for people that do mobile games, that's a kind of reasonable-ish time frame, even if you wanted to start something from scratch rather than repurposing something that you've already got. But I do believe that there's going to be a real market there where people can be successful. And there's every right for people that that can maybe be a little bit questioning about this. We've heard this for a while. We've been following VR for a few years now. We don't have consumer products. And Oculus has been intentionally very coy about announcing timeframes because everyone would rather be quiet than be wrong. And there's a lot that can go wrong with making hardware, with making software as well. But Samsung, turns out, is really good at getting hardware done on time, shipping it out to the channel, and building things. I think we can absolutely count on having the hardware there. And I think Oculus is hopefully slowly building up some level of trust and confidence with us. Being acquired by Facebook is going to turn out to be a really, really good thing from Oculus as a platform standpoint. I was one of the big boosters of the Facebook acquisition, because we could look at the people that have followed Oculus from the beginning, that could see our IT deployments, how every time Oculus tried to do something, our website fell apart or share went down or any of these things. This was not stuff that should have given developers a whole ton of confidence in us being the store that you were going to make your livelihood on. But Facebook knows this infrastructure stuff better than just about anyone in the entire world. And we've gotten a lot of great people from Facebook migrating over to Oculus to be helping us build out this platform that we are aiming for extremely broad usage, that we're hoping we'll get, at the beginning, millions of users, but we are eyes on this distant push of, I want to see a billion people in VR. Zuck wants to see a billion people in VR. There's not a step-by-step plan that gets us there, but we do expect to sell enough units to be making it worth your while to be targeting VR. Now, when you think about making a VR game, it's almost every game that you would make for Gear VR, you should plan on shipping for PC as well. I can't say anything about exactly when PC is going to ship. That's going to be an announcement for somebody else to make when they decide it's time to make it, but I can at least be telling you that if you're making a Gear VR project, be planning on getting it onto PC as well, that it's not building something so that you make it work on Gear VR, and then it's easy to run it on the PC at 90 frames per second, turn up all of the anti-aliasing and run better quality stuff, get the full position tracking. As a developer, you've got to expect that that's going to, targeting multiple platforms should double your potential market size in the near term. I mean, heck, target Morpheus and Valve's headset, and I mean, we're not going to, at this point, we know it's a hard sell to get people making VR, so we're not going to try and say, don't look at anything else. We think that it's our job to make our platform better for you. It's our job to make you love us as a platform. And Valve has obviously done a great job with Steam. Developers love working on Steam. We have we have our work cut out for us to make sure that you can love us more for our platform. The fact that we are going to be on the mobile is significant. Our platform there is something that I'm... So as it is worth saying that the question about exactly what the policies of the App Store is got a lot of debate internally. And internally, we've got the whole spectrum of people views from Wild West to Apple Store to Steam. And we've got people representing each of those areas. Where we did wind up is it is a reviewed store. It's not the Wild West. You can't just throw anything up there. There are some content guidelines. We have already rejected some applications. It's important to communicate with our platform team about what you're doing. This is one of the core decisions that Oculus had to make about what is the business model on all of this, and we are a platform play on mobile. We are expecting that we have to have a whole lot of people selling software through our store to wind up making this good for the company. So the next Gear VR, don't expect anything radically different. What we are working on is hopefully much better optics and ergonomics. Our research team has recently made, hopefully, a breakthrough in understanding some of the things that we have just had trouble coming to grips with the optics and virtual reality. All of these interacting things dealing with the size of the eye box, the amount of distortion when you move your eye in there versus when you're looking straight ahead. And it is one of these that we can't get exactly right with conventional optics. I mean, I'm super excited about all talk about brand new diffractive optics things, and every new optics breakthrough that gets mentioned, I eagerly read, because we can definitely use breakthrough optics here. But I think we can expect much better optics in the next Gear VR. Hopefully better ergonomics, but it will still be essentially the same thing. It will have more top-end performance, but again, I would recommend that you keep the performance that you're trying to do low. You target the kind of lower end, let it run for longer with less heating problems on the newer systems. So what you've got right now, the Gear VR that you can that some of you already have and that you can go out and you can order online, it is a reasonable target platform to be developing for when VR, consumer VR, is going to go wide. So there's a lot of potential advice I can give about exactly what type of content we'd like to see. And there's been some movement in this as well. Like many people have commented about how Oculus has been, we've specifically been about all of these comfortable experiences where a comfortable experience in virtual reality that doesn't bother anyone means the viewpoint doesn't move. You stand or sit in some point, you get the motion here if you've got position tracking, but we have been avoiding, obviously you avoid roller coasters, but we've even been avoiding fairly straightforward navigation systems. And there was a funny thing just last week, or a week before that, we had an executive retreat, and Brendan, the CEO of Oculus, is the most sensitive person probably in the company. And this is an interesting position for the company where it means that he cares more than anybody, just passionately about making the comfortable experience. But it has meant that some things that other people that might be tolerant of more, more aggressive experiences, haven't had the same traction internally. But there was an interesting thing here where we were at this retreat and I sat Brendan down and I put him in a Gear VR product, something that I've been working on that involves navigation that in many ways is almost a worst case. It involves, it has moving around and it has some parabolic motions. And I set him in the swivel chair, said, okay, turn this way, move around here. And he was in there for 20 minutes. And everybody around this, and the executives were pointing, is like, Brendan's in there? So we're still not exactly sure. I mean, maybe it was the wine that he had drunk before the before the test, but the fact is we had a case of a theoretically uncomfortable experience on the Gear VR still being used by somebody that is sensitive. Now, there's no denying that there is a real issue here. You can put people in some of these things, and if you tell them, or worse, if the game encourages them to do certain things, you can make people really sick. I'm kind of surprised we don't have more, people vomiting with Gear VR YouTube videos out by now, because I'm sure it's happened someplace, and someone must have caught it on video. But it's a real issue, but it's maybe not as big of an issue as we were afraid it was. It is possible to do some interesting experiences there. And so I want people to expand a little bit. We don't need another gaze shooter. We've already got a dozen, kind of look at the things and shoot it. And maybe it's good to turn the evolutionary crank a few times on that and evolve towards the perfect gaze shooter that is the best we can possibly do. But I think that genre is gonna get mined out pretty quick. We wanna see, more interesting things that people are doing in VR. Now, there's definitely that we've seen with things like HeroBound, where you can take a game that's a fairly conventional sort of game that people have seen a lot in prior generations and give it a little bit of a VR spin, and it winds up being interesting just because you're in it in a new way. And I tell people that fundamentally, Wolfenstein and Doom, the first first-person shooters, were Gauntlet changed into a different perspective. It had similar mechanics. So I think that there's very much the chance that genres that are either accepted right now or perhaps even genres that have fallen out of favor, that no longer compete head-to-head with the established genres in 2D displays today, may be able to make comebacks in virtual reality. Because there are, the sense of being in there and being isolated with your experience is something that it's hard to quantify, but it really is there. That sense that you can watch a movie on your cell phone when the whole world is around you, but you watch that same movie at half the resolution or a quarter of the resolution, because it's one fraction of one side of the screen there, in virtual reality, and yeah, it's like, okay, the resolution's lower, but you're in this virtual theater and you're cut off from the rest of the world, and there's something to that, something about respecting your media, not sharing what you're doing with all of the other things around you like we do certainly on mobile, and even on PC and other platforms there. So I think that there's opportunities for some fairly conventional things to be done in virtual reality, but I'm personally excited about seeing some more things that have limited tuned navigation capabilities, where when we all thought about virtual reality initially, most of us, I don't think, were thinking of the sit still in a chair experience. We want to explore the virtual worlds. Now, there are things that there are better and worse ways to do this. When you just take an FPS and you control it with a mouse or a joypad, yaw turning on the PC, that's about the worst thing you can do. It's going to be, any programmatic yaw turn is going to be really bad. But on Gear VR, at least, the fact that you can have the swivel chair, or even standing if you're careful, but sitting in a swivel chair and playing a game for an hour is a completely viable thing to do. So if a game is pulled down so that you don't have a lot of jumping up and down and bounding and these other parabolic motions, you don't have easing into the acceleration, you just go. You have forward and, you know, maybe some diagonals or something, but it's a linear motion. A lot of people can play that for quite a bit of time. There's still things to be careful about. You don't want to have really narrow tunnels if you can avoid it, because then you get lots of the parallax moving by. Near field things also wind up accentuating the fact that you don't have the position tracking with it. But I think that there's a lot that can be done in some kind of open areas with generally flat grounds, where right now we build things for a lot of aesthetic reasons, where we've got our lovely arching bridges and deep tunnels and chasms and things. But a lot of gaming can be done with a basically flat plane with interesting things happening that you're moving in and about. So I think that there's a lot of possibility there for the medium comfortable sorts of situations. I mean, some people will still make we will accept in our store uncomfortable experiences. They'll be labeled as such because some people just have iron stomachs, don't care, and want to do some of these crazy things. But I think we're going to be, we're going to be labeling things very explicitly, and it may affect some things like ranking in the store and positioning and things like that. We want to make sure that people that stumble into things don't stumble into the worst case experiences. But one of the important things on all the developments is that going light on the graphics turns out to really not be that big of an issue. Nobody is saying the equivalent of, oh, if only this had screen space, ambient occlusion, and subsurface scattering, this would be pretty neat. You know, that's just not what is making or breaking any of these experiences. You know, the being in there, having it not sort of break your sense of disbelief, you can do a lot with that with relatively simple things. Now, everyone does have kind of a different barrier where in the really high-end PC VR, you can have stuff that you really don't have to apologize for much of anything. You could put somebody in this and say, here it is, it works, no caveats, just go for it. With mobile, we do have there's more caveats and apologies to sophisticated users about saying, it's like, okay, well, you don't want to be doing this leaning around, you don't want to get too close to things, you've got worries with really bright things up in the corners with the lower refresh rates, some of these sort of rules of thumb for it. But in general, if you're making graphics for this and you're building a single pass forward rendered game, just old school graphics. You know, this is, program the graphics as if you were programming on, not one generation ago, but like two consoles ago, like a GameCube or an Xbox One, more towards the GameCube side. And keep it all in a single pass, don't do no G buffers, no post-processing, no crazy shaders at the end, just set it all up and render it. And you can do a lot with that. There's, people that, that think that we need to have this incredible, super-powered, high-end PC to do an interesting game that can deliver our VR experience, it's just not true. There is a lot that can be done with sort of the design aesthetic of earlier generation 3D games, just rendering tons and tons of pixels. I mean, we are still at a 1440p display at 60 frames per second, which is a lot of pixels to render. But there's quite a bit that you can do there. I tell people, just because everybody needs a number, try to stay at 50,000 triangles drawn in a scene, assuming it's stereo and you're running at 60 frames per second. But that's assuming not perfect draw calls, not perfect data. A graphics programmer that wants to turn the screws on that and minimize the draw calls, optimize the vertex data, and keep the shaders simple, you can go up to 100,000 triangles and still hold 60 frames per second. And we do have the asynchronous time warp side of things here, which is another one of those hot button topics inside Oculus, where ATW, as we call it here, it was necessary for Gear VR. Gear VR essentially couldn't be a commercial product without it, because it was just too hard to guarantee that everything that game developers would do would run at 60 frames per second continuously. We've got this where so many of the you can make apps that just run that no problem if you're very, very focused on being a kind of a graphics programmer. If you are kind of an old school graphics programmer that worked on consoles, and you can go ahead, you can make that run almost all the time with our combination of SCED FIFO and all this stuff going on. But most of the Oculus developers that are with us right now come from more of the indie school of things on the PC. And this is not a knock at all on the way game development there is done. It's creativity driven, where you know you go out and you build the game that you want to build. And you know that's wonderful that you can do that now. This was something that you couldn't do 10, 15 years ago. You can pretty much just say, here's my idea. I'm going to cobble it together in Unity and see if it's fun. So it does take more effort than that for virtual reality to hold 60 frames per second on the, you know, on the mobile hardware. So, you know, in general, I'd hope that we wind up seeing some partnerships of the people that, you know, that are doing the creativity-driven games, hooking up with some of the, maybe the older gray beards that have done the lower level, more focused console-oriented sorts of development there to be able to put it together. But you need to pay at least some attention. But the great thing is you don't have to be perfect about it. You know, we do say you want to hold 60 frames per second, but if you have your colossal boss fight explosion and everything happens on the screen and you start missing frames, if that was happening with the low persistence display by itself, then you would have the horrible judder, you know, where just like everything is shaking and it's completely just awful. With the asynchronous time warp, we take the last frame that was there, we reproject it for the rotation of the head, and it ranges from almost unnoticeable to, you know, occasionally if it's really bad and you whip your head over really hard, you can see black coming in at the edge. You can kind of see the edge of what was the screen as it was pulled over and reprojected. This is much more clear-cut on mobile. On PC, where you've got position tracking, it's not as much of a silver bullet, because in the best case, if you're just looking around, then it can still wind up fixing it up. But in the worst case of you've got something here and you're moving side to side, you have motion that doesn't involve any angular change at all, so it winds up looking exactly like a judder. So there's a lot of work going on. It's a lot harder on PC with the diverse ecosystem, but on mobile, it's a critical part of what we're doing with this. And that's, so another thing related to that is the chipsets that wind up going into the hardware here. So Gear VR in domestically was a Snapdragon from Qualcomm with an Adreno GPU. And we had a really great relationship with Qualcomm, and it was really us getting Qualcomm to do the priority extension, some of these other things that made a lot of this possible. So we were really happy with how that relationship went. The Korean Gear VRs wound up using the Mali GPU in Samsung's Exynos chipset, and that was not working as well. We had less time with it. There were some performance problems with it where we had to disable the chromatic deaberration correction at the end. Galaxy wound up being the Mali Exynos only, and I was initially kind of concerned about that. We had a number of things that we were really excited coming from Qualcomm, and if this was still sort of subpar performance, that would have been really unfortunate. But I'm happy to report that the performance is essentially equivalent. And if you turn the clocks all the way up, it actually beats the Note 4 performance in some cases now. I can only assume that come next product cycle that Qualcomm will be deathmatching it out with Samsung again over chipsets. Like, we don't know whether there will be one, two, or potentially more different chipsets. I think it's fair to assume that Imagination Technologies with their Apple stake probably isn't contending for Samsung, and NVIDIA with lawsuits probably isn't contending there. But you may have to, if you're a serious graphics programmer, have to support two different chipsets for optimal performance in different cases. So, but again, don't expect radical change there. Expect that if you want to build something, you can build it on the hardware we have today. You can find out how fun it is. There's enough time to turn the crank a few times on game design ideas, tune it well, get early versions out, get real-world testing feedback, and it can be ready to go when, hopefully, we're all going big and wide later this year. So what we're doing on kind of the SDK side, some of the things to help make this easier, it turns out that right now, I think 90, 95%, almost everybody is using Unity. We do have the Unreal Engine 4 support that is being used by a couple companies internally. Nothing has been published to the store yet with that. It's still a little rougher around the edges. We have a couple people that are doing native code integration. Unfortunately, right now, Unity 5 is not working. That's one of our high priority lists now that it's out of beta to go ahead and get that out. But if you're working on it right now, it's still with Unity 4 code base. We are doing a lot of work internally on the native code support, but we don't expect most developers to be using that. That's really more our internal framework that we're building our apps with. There may be some companies that are doing media-focused apps that really don't benefit by being built inside a game engine can be using that. I have to apologize. It's going to be a little bit of a rough road as we're refactoring a bunch of that. Right now, there's sort of three things jammed together into what we call our VR lib. And it's really all the stuff that was necessary to make our applications and the Unity integration work for shipping. There's the core of the VR API, which is really only a few functions. It's initialize, enter VR mode to set up all of our custom special VR goodness, leave VR mode and read sensor, and then warp swap, just kind of push these things out. There's a bunch of features that are kind of powerful when used in specialized ways that you can only get at this way. We're trying to migrate more of them out to the engine integrations. Things like they're called overlay planes, but layers is a better term that Oculus is trying to adopt now across both PC and mobile. And this is where the standard VR model, you render everything into a view just like it was going to the screen, and then we post-distort it with the distortion correction and chromatic aberration correction and all that stuff going on. The layers support allows you to have a screen done that way and then have it be composited with other layers. Now, in our shipping apps, we use this for areas where we want much higher quality. The cinema screens, the cube map backgrounds in 360 photos, and then in some of our other internal apps where we've got like a web page viewer, a comic book viewer, some of these things where you care about trying to get all the quality that you can out of the display. And I have been remiss in not pushing this out more broadly to developers, because one of the things that I notice most when I kind of review the current crop of VR applications is terrible aliasing in a lot of the, especially UI elements, where things are, when you're drawing text or something and it's sitting there and it's really, really hard to read. And this is one of the things that we could help a lot with this layer support, where I recommend to people now that if you really want to go out and do something experimental and wild with a virtual reality focused user interface, if you want to have floating objects coming around and kind of go for it in an all VR, completely non-traditional UI, then fine. You go ahead and you do that in your game engine as you normally would. But for a lot of games, it's going to be better to do a two-dimensional UI, crop it down, float it on a plane, somewhere in the screen, where you get nice head tracking, you can get much, much better quality text. It's essentially over twice the resolution that you get when you perfectly size an overlay plane, and you can get gamma correction even if your game's not gamma correct, and you can get, it avoids the double resampling. So a lot of these picky, low-level text quality issues that can get better. But this is nitpicking. The things that are going to make VR, a VR application hit or miss are not going to be made or broken by the text quality, but it is something that I see a lot of VR apps not doing the best job on. There's room for improvement there. Similarly with aliasing in general, everybody hopefully can be in a forward rendering mode where you can just turn on MSAA, 2x or 4x. Scenes that aren't really heavy, it's completely feasible to use 4x MSAA here. It looks quite good. If you're doing a lot of things with fancy shaders, if you're using specular bump mapping, it's probably not a good idea. It's going to alias and be kind of a mess almost no matter what we do. We just cannot afford temporal anti-aliasing, multi-tap filters on all these different things on mobile. So staying out of the things that alias, staying with, again, think GameCube. Simple shaders, simple things on here. Don't do super high density. For God's sake, bitmap all of your textures. That's still one of the things that occasionally we see something go by where just like that texture is not bitmapped, and that's just going to be both terrible for performance and visuals. If you, Try to avoid deep blacks because of the two-frame ghosting issue, where if you have star fields tend to be pretty bad, that type of thing, where you've got a solid black, which is perfect pitch black on the OLED, and then you've got bright little pinpricks. You know, you move your head around and you'll see the one-frame ghost of them just hanging around back there. But that matters even in terms of general purpose content. I mean, don't do a Doom 3 with all of the super dark corners everywhere. That will wind up smearing when people look over there. They move back and forth and they'll see the ghosted shimmery kind of after image of the stuff there, which will not be optimal. But the truth is, we still don't know what the best applications are going to be. We don't think that everybody knew there were going to be gaze shooters, and people are doing gaze shooters, and some of them are fun, some of them aren't so great. But there's a lot to explore here, and this is what I want to convince everyone here, that this is a legitimate opportunity, that it is going to be real. If you make something really great, there will be customers there that will be evaluating your work, and there's going to be the opportunity to move a number of units, hopefully be the breakout thing that we all look back here a few years from now and say, well, clearly that was the obvious thing that people should have been doing in VR. It's just not obvious right now. But I can sincerely say that I think this is an important opportunity where people can make a mark that you can't necessarily make in saturated areas elsewhere, and that it can be one of those stepping stones that kind of help you catapult forward. So I got another half hour. I actually took a call for topics on Twitter yesterday, so let me run down the couple list of things that people wanted to go on, and I'll leave some time for open questions after this. So one of the things that came up was 3D capture. And since this is Game Developers Conference, I'm not talking too much about the video and photo side of things. But I think realistically, media is going to be at least half of the uses of VR. We have some anecdotal evidence right now that shows that people are doing, I'm not anecdotal, we have some data that shows that people are spending more time in some of these experiences than the games. We can argue, well, maybe our games aren't very good, but you can counter-argue maybe our experiences aren't that great on there either. But capture is an interesting and exciting area because it's not worked out. We do not have the VR camera you just drop down and you get your experience, because it's clear outside of gaming, there's so much that people want to do with that. Every conference wants to be VR streamed, every sporting event, every play in production. There's so much that can be done there, but it's still sort of an active research problem. You have companies like Samsung with their Project Beyond and Jaunt and a bunch of these other places that are trying to make this a turnkey thing, but if you've watched them kind of set up and do demos, it's not there yet. Panoramic capture is within sight of getting this to just be a super high quality turnkey thing. The Theta little $300 panoramic camera is actually pretty damn neat. It's not spectacular quality, but it fits pretty well with Gear VR, and we've got a little bit of integration there where you take a picture, you get it to your phone, and it just automatically shows up in the 360 photos. So there's going to be a ton of things going on with that. But the exciting areas are eventually getting to light field capture, and you're seeing a lot of buzz about that. There are the ability to then be able to do the full move around and have the full comfortable experience. That's going to be really significant when it gets there, but I'm not expecting that in a turnkey form sort of this year. We're rolling a lot of things on video capture and video presentation and a lot of things at Oculus and Facebook, so there's a lot going on there. So while stereo capture is a hard, messy, ugly thing in virtual reality, and in fact, I hear a lot from people that panoramas and stereo panoramas, that's not even VR. And there's some truth to that, but there's this, looking at it kind of derisively, because it is such a terrible hack. The stereoscopic panoramas that we do, the obvious thing, of course, if you tilt your head like that, it goes completely wrong, and that's highly inadvisable. But even when you're doing just the perfect looking around, yawing, it's kind of right in the middle, and it gets less right as you go out until you move over towards it. And the capture stitching on it is incredibly ugly. There's a lot of artistry that goes into setting up the shoots for that, where the stitching always has shears or smears, and you say, well, we're not going to do anything important here, so we're going to put the ugly area over there and arrange the cameras correctly. But something that worked out really great is synthetically creating these things. While the formula for the stereo panoramas is still this big old hack. It's, you know, you look around here and you change the IPD that you're rendering the camera from based on as you look down, it has to ramp down to zero, because if you look down and you saw it reversed behind you, that's really, really hard on your eyes. So you have to kind of ramp it down from there, but you can choose an IPD. And for a ray tracer, this is a great thing. And this was something that Otoy did a test render for this, and they actually added a feature to their Octane renderer that builds stereo panoramas in this absolutely peak quality for Gear VR version, where it uses our cube map format for the overlay shaders, and it's perfectly sampled, perfectly set up. And those are literally the best images I have ever seen through any VR headset anywhere. If you've seen some of Otoy's work, they have some the things that show off ray tracing, semi-transparent stuff, reflections, ambient, good global illumination. And they've got some, like, a kitchen scene and a bedroom scene. And I see people that will just sit there, and they're like, I could stay in this kitchen for hours just looking at how high quality the renderings are. But what's important about this is sort of our benchmark. So we can say, with this exact display, we can hit this level of fidelity that is incredibly good. So we can start approaching that with our real-time rendering and, you know, eventually be able to be doing that level of quality, both for captured things in the more general form with light fields. And I should also mention that when I saw Otoy's light field work, I went into it, as with so many things, you know, the secret to happiness is reasonable expectations. You know, I had seen some lumographs and light field work before that was generally kind of a blurry mess. It was the sort of thing where you look at this and it's like, okay, it's neat that you can rotate it around and view it from different things, and you can sort of see the future in it, but you're not actually analyzing the quality of the thing in front of you. So I was pleasantly surprised by the light field demos where, you know, what I saw was just where you had a picture window that you could look through, but it was captured, it was synthetically rendered, but you could move around that, and I was surprised by how good it looked. It was nowhere near as crisp as these perfectly pre-rendered stereoscopic things, and I haven't seen them wrap it into a cube all the way around your head, but at this point, I wouldn't be betting against light fields being a significant thing, perhaps sooner rather than later. WebGL. So, let me go to talking about graphics APIs in general. So one of the great features that I'm really sad we're not rolling out with the Galaxy right now, that Qualcomm has the first implementation of the multi-view rendering extension that we've been pushing, where a typical case that we'll see when we're profiling applications is one third of the time goes to doing your game, one third of the time to rendering the left eye, and one third to rendering the right eye. And this is like a typical Unity application. And the idea that, well, we're spending a third of the time basically issuing the same draw calls, the idea that if we can just get the system to buffer everything up, let you issue the whole thing twice, and just change basically some uniforms between them. This is something that we've been pushing with Kronos and with multiple vendors, and Qualcomm actually has an implementation of this now, where I got an email this morning or last night that said it's at Samsung now, we're ready to start sort of testing this. So I doubt it's going to be something that gets rolled out to consumers, but this is a technical direction that we absolutely expect to have going forward into the kind of the next Gear VR, where this is something where it requires appending a little bit of information to all of the vertex shaders, but it does let you issue the commands once, and then it basically gets issued again. On the mobile hardware, this turns out to be extremely convenient because they already, for tiling, have to buffer up an entire frame of graphics. So it really is just a matter of you issue all of that, you change something, and then you issue the whole thing again. So that does nothing whatsoever for the GPU performance, but it can mean one third or better in some cases for certain types of applications, improvement in the CPU side, which is a lot on the power dissipation and thermal load side. So that's a really great thing. But unfortunately, ARM is, for the Mali, they're going to do an implementation of this, but they're further behind, so we don't know when that's going to land. But that's still one of those really exciting things, and a couple other tweaks that they've got that would be great for us in VR. So maybe we can get Samsung to push a new driver out to all of the users, but I wouldn't really hold my breath about that. So The other aspect about multi-view is that if we had a, you'd call a modern graphics API, like Metal Mantle, DX12, Vulkan sort of thing, you could do that pretty much by yourself. You just build a command buffer, you change a mapped variable, and you just run it like that. We can't do that on Android right now. We don't know when Vulkan's going to be adopted, but I'm certainly looking forward to that. That will help for a number of these things. Getting the driver overhead out cuts CPU, cuts power consumption, cuts thermal problems. That'll all be a really good thing. But on the PC side, some of the exciting stuff is that vendors like AMD and NVIDIA are looking at multi-view as an opportunity to do things that actually will make it faster on the GPU, where instead of just issuing the whole commands twice, just run through it once, run through it again, you would set it up so that you could actually draw them simultaneously, which can have a number of benefits. In theory, you can write the vertex shader so it only does a little bit of extra work to generate both of them, and then probably more significantly, if you can interleave triangles or even better, interleave quads between them, you can share texture cache between the left and right eyes. And this is something that could start adding up to pretty significant double-digit percentages increases in GPU performance, which would be a pretty nice thing. But back to the actual question of WebGL, it's one of those things where it is probably unwise to bet against the web in general, but I would say that if anything's going to be kind of a holdout on there, I mean, people argue applications versus native apps versus web apps, and there's arguments for both sides. All of the arguments for native apps are stronger still for VR apps. So there's good reason to not be expecting a web application to be the early phase of virtual reality. But I would not be surprised if once you have asynchronous time warp sorts of things in there, that you can wind up having VR scenes that are interesting rendered by the craziest source data formats. So I expect people will be doing things with that. It's not a major strategic focus at Oculus. There are going to be challenges for people doing that with the way the PC works. It's not going to be happening on mobile anytime real soon. So augmented reality, I've spoken about this a few times where I think in the long run, augmented reality is absolutely going to be something that billions of people. I mean, everyone in the world will want augmented reality in the final form that it comes down to. If it reaches the vision of you put on the sunglasses and you get everybody's name floating over them and your directions routed out for you, just everyone's going to want that. But we're still a long ways from that. And I'm excited about a lot of the technology things that HoloLens is doing. It's one of those nice things. We wish them the very best with that. It's not a competitive position. You will be able to make VR apps that run like that, but it's not a wide field of view. It's not immersive. You can see the, by intention, it's not immersive. So I don't think that there's going to be great crossover or cannibalization with things there. And it's interesting where several of us have had, even in not so great AR applications on, we've rejected a couple AR apps on Gear VR so far because they would have distorted fields of view and it would be the type of thing that would just make you sick pretty quickly. But there's still a magic to that where you get something when you can hold up the little marker or drag something around, and in pass-through when there's no lag or jitter and it is just absolutely on the on your finger or on the controlling device. So there's neat stuff there, but I don't recant a bit my decision that immersive virtual reality is what we do first. And eventually we need to be looking at AR, but I think they're actually reasonably different products unless virtual reality winds up subsuming AR with pass-through. Like I've got a little scheme that, one of the problems with pass-through AR is even if you have stereo cameras there, the problem is that the cameras are still this far off from your eye, so it's still going to be all weird even if you mapped everything correctly because the depth's going to be a little wrong. But there's a way that you could take the camera there, stand it out a little bit, look at a mirror, and get the distances all set up right to actually have it coming from where your eye is, and you could do a super high quality pass-through with reasonable hardware. There's exciting things that we could do there. There are a number of people on Facebook that wanted us to go build one of those because they've got technology that they'd like to try for doing things like facial recognition and other things with that. So It's interesting and exciting, but I'm personally paying almost no attention whatsoever to it because I've just got the things that I got to do in VR. Okay, 15 minutes. Let me see if there's anything else here. Yeah, okay, we'll go to questions. So I guess we're going to run a microphone around or just come up to the microphones. All right, I guess come up.
Just your thoughts on OSVR. Are you guys going to stay native on your APIs and no focus on that at all, or what's the future?
Sorry, say that again.
With OSVR?
Oculus is clearly focused around our own API. I expect that a lot of these things there will be shims that people make to go between them, and it will be possible in some cases to do high-quality products with it, but we are committed to having our own SDK. Yep.
Hi. In the past, you, with the id Tech engines, open-sourced and GPL'd your work after a time. Do you plan to do that with your demos at Oculus?
So Oculus has been obviously releasing a lot of our SDK source. I mean, people have noticed that there was a migration where when we had tracking, all the vision code was not released as open source, but all the mobile stuff has been. We can argue about licenses and different cases there. Oculus is, I wouldn't say it's not an ideological foundation that we're on, but almost everybody in Oculus is very supportive of this. We want to get a lot of code out. We talk about, one of the discussions that we have is exactly what we want to release for our SDKs, where I could argue that releasing the full source for all the first-party Oculus apps would be a good thing to do, but there's the counter side of that in that they're no longer simple. They're hard to find out. Once you get a real application, it's not the best demo. So we may still release more things, and I've got a number of projects, like little VR apps that I've done that are kind of interesting but not commercial products that could conceivably go out. It's not, again, our top priority, but we are all sympathetic to it, and I expect we'll continue to release a lot of code, but probably not everything.
Hey, cool.
Yep.
Okay. Hi.
Do we have another microphone over there, or is it just...
Yeah, there's a mic here.
Okay, let's go over there.
What are your thoughts on VR controllers and body tracking?
Okay, VR controllers, I've said before, and I continue to hold this position, I'm glad I'm not in charge of doing them because it is not one of these clear-cut decisions. It's a tough situation because one camp can say you're not going to be a good VR experience until we have VR controllers. You want to see your hands there. You want some tracking there. There's a magic in doing that. But the other side of it is that there's a ton of things that people are doing that won't benefit at all from that, having the video and photo exploring and a lot of things that people are doing on Gear VR without that. So do you wind up making something that raises the price for everybody when potentially half of the people would never want to use it? It's already a problem just with the game pads, where it's an argument about does every Gear VR ship with a game pad or is it an accessory? And right now it's an accessory, which is tough for game developers. That we argue that with each product, we'll continue to argue that going forward, and hopefully it'll be a better game pad in the future. But controllers are a tough topic. My personal feeling is that mobile will evolve to the point where we use the phone camera, probably with external optics, to provide inside-out position tracking at some level of quality and also gesture control. So Oculus has recently brought on, we acquired some external people, a company that specializes in position tracking and gesture tracking. So there's work going on with that. And my gut feel is that when we're talking about huge numbers of people, that VR will probably wind up being done with a simple gestural situation, and there will be games that take advantage of using the hand tracking in that volume, and it will be more the dedicated gaming devices. PCs, obviously, we care about controllers there. Sony's doing work with their controllers. It's going to be more significant for game-focused things. I don't think it's going to come to play on mobile for the foreseeable future, which is a year or two.
Thanks.
All right.
What is the current state of Armadillo Aerospace?
So my aerospace work is in hibernation right now. I do expect, I'm telling people that after VR is all sorted out, I'm probably going to go take another swing at that. There's I look back at it as something that I did not succeed at. There's no way to, I can say I got a lot accomplished, I did a lot of interesting things, but in the end, it failed. It was not able to stand on its own, accomplish enough things that would make it a running concern without being a government contracting shop, which wasn't what I wanted to do. So I packed things up. It's one of those things like rocket systems and launch system dynamics. These are things that when I can't sleep at night and I'm sitting in bed, I'm thinking about rocket engines and when I'm not thinking about virtual reality. So I'll probably get back with it, but that's also not in the foreseeable future of the next couple years. Yeah.
I was wondering what your thoughts are on something like Project Tango into the Gear VR.
So what's interesting about position tracking is position tracking for VR needs to be way more precise than what you think for an AR demo. And this is something that's caused a lot of people confusion over the last couple years, where you see it's like, oh, I saw this video on YouTube or somebody holding something, clicking around. Can't you just put that essentially on the headset and get your position tracking? But when you do that, even on things that that are decent, something that's perfectly fine for a controller, like a Hydra. I mean, lots of people did this on DK1, and I was doing this on the even earlier hacks where you take apart a Hydra and you put it on there, and it's like, ooh, position tracking, but it's kind of doing this juddery bit. So Project Tango, at least when we saw it, which was a while ago, was not at the same sub-millimeter level precision. I'm sure they're continuing to work on it. And again, I firmly believe that inside-out tracking is possible in reasonable scenarios, even without the depth augmentation of an extra sensor there. So I absolutely believe it's possible, but we have yet to see somebody say, here it is, it's great, try it. We haven't gotten the killer demo yet that satisfies everyone and says, this is as good as like our outside-in tracking on like Crescent Bay.
Hi, Asif Khan with Shack News. I'm curious, you're focused on developing software development kit for mobile right now, but you are a very talented software developer. Is there a victory condition where you will be done or at least remotely accomplished your project in developing the SDK and you can move back into developing maybe VR software?
So I'm actually going to be spending a lot more time this year on applications. I'm braced for a year of crunch on this, where we have all these things that I want everybody to be in a panic about this consumer launch. We are going to hang ourselves out there and be judged, and I'm going to do my damnedest to make sure that the judgment comes back favorable. But most of my work is actually in applications now. I wrote the original core of of all three of the shipping Oculus first party. They were taken over by the other engineers that made them actually good apps, but a year ago I had that core written for all of them, and I'm doing some similar work for social VR experiences now. I'm still gonna do, the company doesn't understand it, but I'm gonna do my virtual reality comic book shop, and it's gonna be awesome, and it's gonna pave the way for virtual commerce. And anyone wants to come work with us in Dallas on that, I'm serious about this. Victory condition, I can't imagine it happening within the next couple years. There is so much to be done. We are going to be, it is a treadmill being on the mobile stuff with every 6 months there is this brand new platform which we see too few weeks before it winds up hitting hitting consumers' hands. There winds up being internationalization, multiple chipsets, different OS versions coming from Google that we update in the middle. There's a ton of work involved in all of that, and it's not a victory condition there. That's a treadmill that we have elected to get on, and I think it's good for us. Technically, we are getting most of the things that we need from like an SDK standpoint. We are finally going back through and making the SDK really good as we're factoring it out. I mean, anybody that's looked through the SDK, you can look through how it evolved over the last 6 months in the developer releases, and it was written in a hell of a hurry, and it's not spectacular, but we're making it better now. We'll get to kind of a victory condition on that hopefully within the next couple months, but there's a lot more to be done, and I don't expect to be taking a break from this in the foreseeable future.
Oh,
yeah.
Thank you.
Hi, we are developing games for non-US-based NodeForce, and at about the end of the last year, VR shell and VR service updated, and it stopped supporting those devices. What we are doing is we are running on an outdated version of the VR service and shell, but we are getting bugs in the new Unity versions. So we are still on Unity 4.6 beta. And when we aggregate it, we get black tearing issues. We get issues with OpenGL 3 flickering on the right eye. And I would like to know if there is any news on this.
Wait, so why can't you update to the latest one again?
When we update the VR service and shell, it displays to us our phones is not supported. An update will be rolling out soon, and we ask at the forums, and they're saying, yeah, an update will be rolling out soon, but we don't have any information on that. So the only way to run now is to run on the old VR service and shell.
Did you buy this phone like in Europe or something?
It's a South American phone, so it's
not. Oh, those are not supported at this moment. We are still rolling out our internationalization across all the different territories. I don't know when that's actually going to be coming into in the schedule. It's prioritized, obviously, and we do expect to have, certainly by later this year, coverage over all the territories Samsung supports, but. Yeah, some of them are just not supported. I mean, the ability to hack around that, yeah, I mean, in the end, we just have to say that's not supported. I mean, if you can do anything with it, that's better than nothing, but we would say you have to buy a phone from a supported territory.
Okay.
But eventually, I would expect it will function, but it's going to be dependent on when the internationalization rolls around. Sorry.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
I'm curious to your opinion about Vulkan. And then I'm wondering, when are you going to fix the OpenGL libraries? Because right now, the SDK is completely broken in so many ways. If you're trying to do an OpenGL application and integrate it into an engine, I've been trying to do it for 3 weeks and asking questions on the forum and get very little answer and, you know, trying every version of everything. And
so in terms of integrating the native code with your own engine?
Okay, it's very broken on OpenGL, and there's lots of people complaining about it.
So just recently, I ported a significant OpenGL native code base on mobile to our SDK, and I made a shim in between their code base and our code, which should be an excellent example for anybody trying to do it. It's definitely possible to do it. I mean, we could track down what your problems are with whether it's context state or something, but
there's a lot of things that aren't explained. It says you should run a shim here, and we do stuff, and then you hook into things that are not explained at all, and you're trying to hide things that when you draw to the frame buffer, you're not actually drawing to a frame buffer, you're drawing to an FBO. But then it turns out when you query what's bound, it actually gives you that FBO. It doesn't give you zero.
You can't draw to the frame buffer in VR mode.
If you query OpenGL, what am I bound to? You haven't intercepted that. So
we don't intercept anything in OpenGL.
Okay, it's really strange what's going on.
Because we do have, there are a couple ship titles that are using native integration. So it is possible to work on, but as I said, 95% of our developers are on Unity, so there's not a lot of priority going for this. The best advice is to look at the Unity integration source code, because that's kind of the minimal case for hooking up a third-party OpenGL application with our interface. Soon there will be this new interface shim that I built for another title that will be probably the best documentation for how to set something else up.
What's your recent stance on real-time ray tracing with regards to VR?
To go back to the Vulkan, I didn't address Vulkan. So we are represented on on the OpenGL ARB with Kronos. We've participated in that, and I think Vulkan's going to be great. I think that it was great that AMD basically contributed Mantle as a somewhat battle-tested API now, rather than us making it all up from scratch. And I think that it's going to be a positive thing. We really don't want to fall back into the bad old days of every every platform or every chipset has its own custom API. There's still a hazard that we're going to wind up there, but hopefully Vulkan is going to be good enough to forestall the worst of that, where everybody winds up with a custom separate one. So real-time ray tracing. Again, Otoy has some interesting demos of using cloud-based rendering for doing ray tracing on some things mixed with some things done locally. Now, one of the things people point to with ray tracing is the idea that you could ray trace natively the screen with the distortion already applied. And that's true, you could do that, but then you couldn't apply time warp to it effectively. So it that turns out not to actually be a big win for it. I've looked at a number of hardware ray tracing companies and all the software ray tracing work. It's still, VR is probably not going to be the entry point for real-time ray tracing. I think that it will probably show up in something that, you know, that is more focused on accuracy and precision and shadows rather than where we have to have these hard real-time numbers. There's the exciting possibilities of doing render just what you can, so that if you could set things up so that you ray trace, and if you only get 700,000 samples made, then you just filter in between those to generate the image that you want. And that's interesting to pursue, but it doesn't look like the numbers really close, even for hardware-accelerated ray tracing on mobile. The cloud situation is one of those where we can throw almost obscene amounts of processing power at these tasks, and it's a neat demo, but I'm also not super excited about that being a great consumer way of doing things. You can make some amazing demos but using that type of processing power is a charge per minute deal, and I don't think a lot of gamers are going to buy into that. Again, eventually ray tracing is going to win, but eventually might still be a ways off. It seems that the dynamics between performance and memory keep sort of tracking just to the point where ray tracing doesn't quite make sense. If we had 10 times as much memory, then ray tracing could make more sense because you could have data sets where the log 2 advantage over linear rasterization starts really paying off. But where we are right now, you run out of memory before you run into the long run performance benefits of it.
I'm sorry, unfortunately we have no more time for questions.
Okay, well, I guess if anyone wants, I'll be out in the hall, we can carry on a little further. Thank you all.